Вот. И таким образом мы сейчас приглашаем, наконец, итальянскую женщину. Now we have Italian lecture, which was from Vincenza, that she was able to stand all our Russian English, and she's going to talk about righteous among the nations and the Emilia-Romagna region and exhibition. Please.
Good evening. I'm very happy to participate at this event, and thank you very much for the invitation. First of all, I would like to briefly describe the Jewish Museum in Bologna, founded. Yes. Founded in 1999, the museum is located in a beautiful classic building of the 15th in the area referred to as the ex-ghetto of the Jews. The museum was created to preserve, study, and promote the awareness and value of the immense Jewish culture and heritage, which is deeply rooted in Bologna and in many localities of Emilia-Romagna, one of the regions of the northern Italy. So we can see the position in Italy of the region. To manage the museum, a special foundation was created with the city council and the province of Bologna, the region of Emilia-Romagna, and the local Jewish community, all participating in the initiative. The museum is both historical and didactical. It proposes various historical pathways assisted by means of various communication instruments. The main theme is the Jewish identity from its origin until today, along with an exhibition path dedicated to the presence of Jews dating far back in time in both Bologna and Emilia-Romagna. The museum also has the goal of being a concrete link between the territorial realities and the architectural, artistic, and documentary presence of the Jewish community. This is some picture from the heritage in the region. Also, the museum is an important cultural meeting point in the city for the numerous activities that it hosts and organizes. His presence. The Remembrance Day has always represented an important occasion for the museum to illustrate and reflect on the themes on the Holocaust. The theme of the Reich House in particular was already addressed in 2010 with an exhibition of the Yad Vashem entitled Beza, a Code of Honor, Muslim Albanian who rescued the Jews during the Holocaust, and in 2011 when an exhibition on the Reich House Luigi Varoli was hosted. For the Remembrance Day 2013, the museum together with the Jewish community in Bologna planned and organized the historical documentary exhibition on the Reich House among the nations in the Emilia-Romagna region, the first exhibition of its kind in Italy, with the main purpose of bringing to the attention of the public at large the story of 54 Reich Houses who took action in the Emilia-Romagna area, and at the same time to honor and remember non-Jewish persons who saved Jews during the Holocaust. I want you to remember that the Yad Vashem acknowledged 524 Italians as Reich House among the nation, and of this number, exactly 54 were active in Emilia-Romagna. It should be stressed that the first Reich House one given recognition in Italy was Ezio Giorgetti of Bellaria, a locality near Rimini and Ravenna in 1964, while the most recent one, in order of time, were the married couple Attilio e Iole Cornini of Parma, officially given recognition in 2011. This is a map of the Emilia-Romagna with the different localities and the name of the Reichshaus. Various elements emerged and were emphasized by the exhibition. First element, briefly, the historical background, the Jews in Italy from the emancipation to persecution. The history of the Jews in Italy is the oldest one of the Jewish diaspora. Their presence goes back to the second century AD, and during the centuries that followed, the Jewish presence was consolidated with many Jews settling down in this country. The Jews in Italy lived the experience of the ghettos instituted by the Pope, but the small and large community, notwithstanding the economic and physical trial, conserved the model and social living and developed an important cultural life. With national unity from 1816 onwards, the Jews became committed, just like other non-Jewish citizens, to the building of Italian nation. Integrated in the civil life of the country, they were allowed access to the sphere of the profession and in education, as well as to the various sectors of the economy, the armed forces, public administration, and politics. A new impulse was registered also in the increment in the population of Italian Jews. From the approximated 35,000 Jews at the time of the national unity, the population grew to 48,000 on the basis of the census taken in August 1938, so to become about one per thousand of the total Italian population. The victory of fascism in 1922 did not initially influence the relation between Jews and not Jews. In fact, antisemitism was not initially a central element in the ideology and design of the fascist policy, as it was instead for Nazis. Only from 1934 onwards did the international political scene make antisemitism a major issue for the fascist dictatorship. Between 1936 and 1938, the Jews were depicted as enemies of Italy and of fascism, traitors, thieves, and opportunists. In this context, we find the roots of the political fascist persecution, which was validated by the legislative action taken between September and November 1938. They did not allow Jews to take part in the social life of the country, reducing the areas which they could operate. They denied them access to instruction, leading to expulsion of Jewish foreigners. As early as 1933, numerous Jews fleeing from Germany and from the territories occupied by the Nazis were beginning to take refuge in Italy. There were German, Polish, Hungarian, Yugoslavian, Czech, and Slovakian Jews all fleeing deportation and in transit for the USA and for Palestine. With the outbreak of the war and the Italian participation along with Germany, June 1940, the situation of the Jews got worse. New harassments were added to already severe restrictions on their life. They began the internment on the anti-fascist Italian Jews and foreign Jews. It was the foreign Jews who were submitted to the prescription of free internment, meaning obligatory stay. Between 1940 and 1943, there were more than 20,000 localities in northern Italy where foreign Jews lived in a condition of free internment, mixing with the local population. With the armistice on 8 September 1943 and with the German military occupation that followed, there was the start of the most brutal phases of the anti-Jewish persecution, characterized by the extension of the Nazi plan to carry out mass extermination. The policy of making arrests and deporting persons to Auschwitz and other extermination camps began from the mid-October onwards in active collaboration also with the RSI, Italian Social Republic authorities. However, many Jews were able to escape capture and certain death and living in hiding. Thanks to the offer of help provided by an important part of the Italian population. At the risk of their own life and liberty, many Italians made every effort to save the Jews with gestures of spontaneous hospitality or with the creation of clandestine networks of assistance. The percentage of survivors in Italy was very high, thanks to the great wave of solidarity and the active participation of the Italian population in the action on the relief. What kind of person were the 54 righteous ones on Emilia Romagna? Most of the persons were simple, humble, frequently farmers or mountain dwellers. Some were office workers, artisans, shop owners, a few military persons, a magistrate, a Red Cross nurse, and seven Catholic priests. It is important to emphasize that the members of the Catholic Church played a key role in the attempts to save the Jews. Notwithstanding the official silence of the Vatican regarding the matter of the Shoah, convents, monasteries, orphanages, and other religious institutes in Italy, and consequently also in the region of Emilia-Romagna, were safe hiding places for Jews in flight. Along with the action taken by the individual rescuer, dictated by the spontaneous goodwill and generosity, the exhibition also evidenced the choral effort at saving Jews, which involved family groups or the population of entire villages as model of solidarity and sacrifice. There were also numerous cases of Jews who were helped by the partisans to safely escape to Switzerland through the mountains. It also evidenced the action of the underground rescue network, among which Delazem played a decisive role. Delazem, Delegation for Assistance to Jewish Emigrants, was an organization of Jewish resistance which was active in Italy between 1939 and 1947 and which distributed economic help to interned and persecuted Jews. I would you present only one story of these 45 stories. The youngest of Villa Emma of Nonantola. The name of Arrigo Beccari and Giuseppe Monreali, Right House of the Nation, are connected with the rescue of 73 Jewish youth who took refuge in Villa Emma in Nonantola, near Modena. The youth come from Germany, Austria, and Yugoslavia, and were all orphans who had lost their parents in concentration camps. All between 6 and 20 years of age, they actually going to Palestine, but who got blocked by the German and Italian occupation of Yugoslavia in 1941. In June of 1942, this youngster reached Nonantola, where Delazem arranged to rent Villa Emma specifically for them and to take care of their needs. The children were welcomed with great cordiality by the inhabitants of the village and remained under the protection of the local physician, Giuseppe Monreali, and of the Catholic pastor, Don Arrigo Beccari, two courageous men who shared the belief that the fascist injustice was intolerable. After the armistice was annunciated, the very evening of September 8, 1943, fearing a reaction from the German occupation, some adult coordinator of the group of Villa Emma asked Monreali to help them get false documents and a safer place of refugee. Monreali immediately set out to find safe refugees, and thanks to the hope of Don Arrigo Beccari and other priests, a certain number of the boys and girls were hidden in the Abbey Seminary, while others quite rapidly found protection with the various families in the village. Meanwhile, Monreale and Don Beccari, with the help of Delazem, organized the escape of the youngers to Switzerland, which actually took place in October of 1943. All the children were saved from harm. When the war ended, many of them went to Palestine. Many others continued to keep in touch and maintain their friendship with the families in Nonantola that had helped protect them and keep them safe. To finish, the memory of Reichshaus in Emilia-Romagna. It is a well-known fact that ceremonies honoring the Reichshaus were held at the Yad Vashem and that for each Reichshaus one, a tree has been planted in their honor in the garden of the Reichshaus. I would instead like to point out of this time how, in the name of the Italian Reichshaus of Emilia-Romagna, the home city municipality have a frequently dedicated monuments, named streets, and public park of specific section of museum. Since 1987, Cotignola has created the Park of Memory along the banks of the Seno River with a memorial stone dedicated to these heroes with the names of the person rescued on one side and the names of the rescuer on the other. The exhibition, sponsored by the Jewish Museum of Bologna, has been very successful. It's evident that the real-life story about the person who were saved and about their rescue have particularly touched the hearts and minds of the public, bringing up still other memories and deeds. In fact, the seemingly boring acts of charity and goodwill end up being the most striking and memorable recollection of people's visit to an exhibition. And I would like to conclude the presentation with the word of Primo Levi when he described his rescue, Lorenzo Perroni, in If This Is a Man. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Yeah? Everything in time. Point, point.